is my right hand, as you can see. Chers amis, dear friends, welcome. I greet and thank you all of you who, by your presence, show your respect and esteem for Pope Francis, who mark the sixth anniversary of his election as successor of Peter on March 13 of this year. As you know, we honor the event close to the feast of St. Peter and Paul on June 29, and of course, the weather at this time of the year allow us to enjoy the beautiful ground upon which this apostolic nunciature is situated. We like to speak of the apostolic nunciature as the house of the Pope in Canada. And so, welcome to this house, one and all. En particulier, je salue les représentants des gouvernements fédéral, provinciaux et municipaux, les membres de la communauté diplomatique, en particulier mes amis et mes frères, les ambassadeurs, les autorités religieuses des différentes traditions religieuses, les amis et les voisins de l'Annonciature. Et je remercie également ceux qui, bien qu'ils ne pouvant pas être avec nous aujourd'hui, ont envoyé des messages personnels de félicitations, notamment le gouverneur général du Canada, son Excellence Julie Payette, et le très honorable Justin Trudeau, Premier ministre du Canada. J'ai été profondément ému par leurs messages personnels. On this feast of the Pope, and here in his house, many might be asking, will the Pope come to Canada? A question I am asked with a certain regularity. With deep conviction, I answer yes, although I must immediately add that as for the time and exact date, only the Lord knows. Meanwhile, for those who wish to observe and follow him and his activities, Pope Francis continues to show forth the broad outlines of his ministry. Allow me to touch upon two aspects that have become even more visible this past year. They are distinct, but deeply related to each other. The first is linked to a unique image that Pope Francis has used since the beginning of his pontificate, the image of the church as a field hospital. It comes from the gospel story of the Good Samaritan. Pope Francis sees the church as a community of men and women who live for others, who care for those in need, for those who are injured, for those who find themselves on the margins of life. But in order to heal others, we need to be cared for and healed ourselves. Remember the proverb, physician, heal thyself. Saint Gregory Nazianzen, a great father of the church, expressed the meaning of this proverb with these words. First, purify yourself, and then purify. First, let yourself be taught by wisdom, and then instruct others. First, become light, and then enlighten others. First, draw close to God, and then lead others to God. First, be saints, and then sanctify others. Precisely to help and ensure the good health of the church, which in recent time has found itself sick and wounded by the serious scandals of sexual abuse, Pope Francis is leading a serious and ongoing process of healing and reconciliation, a process which has had one of its most significant moments in the convocation last February of bishops and religious superiors from all around the world on the protection of minors in the church. It is a process, an ongoing process. We are not asked, Pope Francis is telling the church, to ignore or hide our wounds. A church with wounds can understand the wounds of today's world and make them her own, suffering with them, accompanying them and seeking to heal them. A wounded church does not make herself the center of things, does not believe that she is perfect, but puts at the center the one who can heal those wounds, whose name is Jesus Christ. At the conclusion of the February meeting on the protection of minors in the church, Pope Francis offered these powerful words. The church thus restates her firm resolve to pursue unstintingly a path of purification, questioning how best to protect children, to avoid these tragedies, to bring healing and restoration to the victims, and to improve the training imparted in seminaries. An effort will be made to make past mistakes opportunities for eliminating this scourge, not only from the body of the church, of course, but also from that of society. In this context, I am very pleased to note that the protection of minors has been a major priority of the church in Canada since the 1980s. The historical engagement of the Canadian Conference of Catholic Bishops in the area of prevention remains relevant and valuable to this day. Their recent document, Protecting Minors from Sexual Abuse, a call to the Catholic faithful in Canada for healing, reconciliation, and transformation, is a most valuable resource for Catholic bishops and religious superiors in Canada and around the world. It was held up as a best practice at the important meeting at the Vatican last February. L'autre aspect que je mentionne brièvement, laissant à votre curiosité le désir de l'approfondir, est le ferme engagement du pape.